On this Diwali, let's take an opportunity to further a conversation, which I repeat, has to be had. The way it has been, the way we have attempted to have it, perhaps requires a little bit of a modicum of a change. But it needs to be driven to a conclusion. We have to, in this country, be able to agree on what is good, bad, and ugly. And our inability to agree on certain things, certain core fundamentals, is making our society a lot more complicated than ideally it needs to be. One of these is the concept, conceptualization of Ram Rajya. Now, as soon as you mention that term in the modern Indian context, there would be people in the New York Times who would go, go crazy. Oh my God, what are they talking about here in India? If you talk about here in India, it somehow becomes Modi, BJP, right, RSS, Hindu Rashtra agenda. You discuss it in the context of the Ram temple, the same things takes place. So we are taking it in the larger context, right? Now, look at what you're seeing on your screens. And I've done this so often, of the representation of the logic of Rama in the story of good versus evil across the world, over large parts of Southeast Asia, where it is not taken in a Hindu religious context, where the Ramayana or the values that are represented by the epic of the story of Ram and the logic of governance which was presented are not taken in a religious value. So let's open up this conversation. Indol Sen Gupta is with us, Sumit Peer and Abhijit Chawda is with us. Indol Sen Gupta, is Ram Rajya by nature a Hindu chauvinist construct?
Not at all, far from it. Rishabh, here's the big point that we need to understand. Around the world, more and more people are talking about intellectual framework that allows us to bring about a bipartisan consensus on the most important things about our society. And Ram Rajya is one of those things. If you look at the story of Ramayana, the Lord Rama's consistent bipartisan attempt to build consensus and keep war as only the final resort. This bipartisan consensus attempt depicted by Lord Ram in the Ramayana, and that is the fundamental framework of Ram Rajya, which makes it so valuable to us now in the 21st century. Because what we need today, more than ever, Rishabh, are these bipartisan consensus building frameworks which keep any, militaristic solution as a last ditch attempt. And I think Lord Ram and the Ramayana and gives us an opportunity to use Ram Rajya as that bipartisan intellectual framework.
Okay, Indol, in 91, when we attempted to come to a conclusion towards what the end of history is, what human values, not Christian values or Islamic values or Sharia versus the commandments, eventually we will draw a conclusion. Now, it might happen in our lifetimes, it might not, but eventually the human race will draw a conclusion to what are core human values of an evolved human race. Maybe when the robots try to take us over, we'll understand this, or when the aliens show up, we'll understand it, but eventually we will. In that, what will be the contribution of the core Indic values that are coming out of the conceptualization of Ram Rajya, or the conceptualization of an Ashoka Dhamman, Dhamma, Ashokan Dhamma? What will be the contribution of us here in this civilization to the final construct of human values?
The biggest contribution would be that Indic civilization has always focused not on infrastructure alone, not on wealth alone, not on militaristic values alone, but fundamentally the Indic way of thinking focuses on how to be a human being. We're talking about Ram Rajya today on this show. What is the lesson of Lord Ram? The lesson of Lord Ram is, how do you become truly human? You know, Lord Ram is obviously held as a divine figure, and so he is, but in being an avatar, in living among human beings and living with the dilemmas of human beings, he teaches us the dignity that must be upheld in order to be truly human. For me, the story of Ram Rajya and the story of Lord Ram and Indic civilization comes from this great idea that the divine is not far away from us.
Mm.
The divine is in our everyday. And the lesson, if there is one, is how to make that divine part of what we would call everyday practice.
Okay, Abhijit, there is so much that we must examine, which is being examined in the modern context, right? I mentioned the Ashokan Dhamma, right? I mean, from which our everything seems to come from, the wheel in the tricolor, the chakra, to the pillars, to technically the conceptualization of a Ram Rajya. And I'm taking a very interesting example on our screens. I've taken it before, and you've had that conversation with me of Thailand on our screens, right? Where the embracing of a Ram Rajya is both within and without. So within a Hindu context and without in terms of a government, in a governance context. In this, when we talk about Christian values globally as an aspirational thing, when we talk about, well, Sharia or Islamic values or the commandments that come out of Judaism and Christianity between old and new, what is then Indic values and when do they make that global contribution?
Right, so if we see the Ramayana has been adopted throughout Asia, going from Japan to China to Mongolia to Thailand and all the other Southeast Asian countries, and they all have their own unique versions of it. So to look at it in the larger context, who was Lord Ram? He was our greatest king. He was the ideal king. And if you look at Ram Rajya from that perspective, it is essentially a set, it is a moral and ethical framework of how to conduct your business as a king, as an administrator, as a ruler, how to run a kingdom, and how to live your life in the most moral way possible. So in certain cases, you will find that war is the first option when certain things happen. So it's not like you're looking for a bipartisan or tripartisan consensus. It's about living according to a moral code, according to the Indic moral code, which is enshrined in our Vedas and all our ancient philosophical texts. So in my opinion, that is what Ram Rajya is, and that is what we should strive for. That is what we mean. It is not about Hindu chauvinism or about majoritarianism or any of that thing, which is portrayed.
Okay, so if I would take the obvious parallel, which will be an Arthurian parallel, right? That you created an, a King Arthur who's this ideal king who is chivalrous and stands for good versus evil and dragon slaying, and he sits on a round table because all men and women should be equal. In that parallel, Abhijit Chawda, when movies are made about King Arthur as an aspirational character and 1,000 years of European British history is being talking about it. Why are then people here still cynical and doubtful when we are talking about a Ramayana, and it is seen as if you are Ramayana, if you are re-watching Ramayana in this country, you have to be Hindu?
It's because of the inherent mental colonization that we are unaware of. Everybody, including me, is mentally colonized in some way or the other. Because of our education system, because of the intellectual and socio-cultural milieu that we are in this country. Ever since independence, we have not undone any of the institutions of colonialism. We are continuing in the same way as the British were ruling us. And that is the reason why we are not even aware of the fact that
So what do we do about it now? I mean, I'm trying to figure out what must we do about it. This now exists as a premise. What do we do about it?
We have to start with the education system. We have to reform it. We have to teach our true history. Even if we don't know the correct date of the Ramayana as of now, we have to teach our children the history and especially the culture of our country.
So how do I teach a modern day context rather than just a story of where he went to Lanka and bad guy and killed him and who had kidnapped his wife and he brought her back? Sumit P, same question to you. I'm giving you not an exact but a logical parallel of an Arthurian parallel, right? So when we are watching a nice Bollywood movie with a, you know, A-grade Bollywood Hollywood actor, you know, is sitting and he's drawing his sword, and we're not talking about Merlin and Arthur in a typically Christian context, right? We're talking about, this is good governance. This is what good governance should represent. Okay? But when we talk about Ram Rajya, it is still being discussed in a religious context. Why?
I think, Rishabh, the answer is very simple. First of all, Ram Rajya is a perfect state of empire where rule of the law, equality, liberty, fraternity, and things like untouchability do not exist. It's a perfect system of governance and way of life, what we call it Ram Rajya. Ram Rajya is only the synonym used. So where do we draw our inference from? We draw it from Lord Rama, who exactly practiced this and showed to the world and showed to our civilization how this can be done. Now, the problem is if you are the oldest civilization and you survived for 20,000 years, there are a lot of people who get insecure about you. Point number two, when you have an Islamic invasion of 600 years, British civilization, British invasion of 200 years, then you have communism smeared as secularism, where anything Hindu is seen as communal and anything non-Hindu is seen as secular. That is where the problem comes. So now Lord Rama is seen as a Hindu king. While he has taught the world the way of life, the world, the model of perfect governance practiced on planet Earth. And take the contrary view, Rishabh. You always mention that. Look at Indonesia, the highest Muslim country. What is their airline? Garuda. What is Garuda? The Vahan of Lord Vishnu. They did not change it. They still have Saraswati and Ganesha on their notes. They still have Ramayana being played and telecasted in Indonesia, which is the highest Muslim country, because they wanted to take good out of Ramayana. They wanted to take good governance, good ways out of Ramayana. And what did we do? Because Ramayana Ramayana Hindu.
It is not, so let's communalize. I'm trying to figure this out.
Kill it. So to kill things in this country, Rishabh, we communalize them.
Okay, so
we communalize them and try to bury them.
I'm trying to get this out.
This is impossible now.
Okay, so if we can read our Kautilya's, right? And Kautilya's is contemporary to Chandragupta Maurya, okay? Grandfather of Asoka. And we can read our Machiavellis and our Sun Tzu's and our von Clausewitz and our Friedrich Nietzsche. I think I have the working title for Hindol's next book on lessons in governance from Ramayana and Ram Rajya. What are the lessons in governance, Hindol Sen Gupta, from this kind of an Arthurian model of governance?
The biggest lesson, of course, is that while the best way to wield power is to not be attached to power. And this is, of course, a classic Vedantic lesson too, that you do not get attached to the material acquisition, including the material acquisition of asangoham, right? That great lesson of non-attachment. Lord Rama wielded power effectively because he was fundamentally not attached to power. He was the greatest warrior because he fundamentally had no ego in the application of his war skills. This non-attachment is so driven into Indian culture. The idea of a monk king, the idea of a monk ruler is so deeply ingrained in our culture. And by monk, remember, I don't necessarily mean that the person cannot have a family, because clearly Lord Ram did have a family. Hmm. But he was not attached to perpetuating his material benefit, the benefit only for himself through his to the applications of his power, whether through his kingdom.
That context, Hindol Sen Gupta, if we told young people out there that maybe you should study, as history is meant to be studied, for lessons within the Ramayana and his various transliterations and interpretations, for good models of governance, for good models on how to live your life, would we be telling that individual to somehow follow Hinduism?
No, not at all. I mean, we learn about, what is international relations, for instance? The entire study of international relations, in a sense, is based on Judeo-Christian notions of power and power structures, right? And it's changing a lot, obviously, today with the introduction of something called global international relations or global IR. But the fundamentals of even international relations as we study today is based on Judeo-Christian ideas of how states and how should behave and how power should be wielded. So if today we tell people that indeed civilizationally India must or India could teach lessons of how to wield power through the Ramayana, it's not about telling people to convert and become a Hindu at all. Not at all.
Okay. Abhijit Chawda, why would a Ramayana be taken or Ram Rajya be taken in a Hindu context, where a Kautilya might not be taken in a Hindu context? Why is it ascribed to religion when the story is not about, we don't get commandments per se, the thou shall or thou shall not out of the Ramayana. It's a story in the end, and it's a story teaching you the trials and tribulations of governance and the moral difficulties that one must face and how one transcends them, and in a sense good versus evil. But why is it seen in a religious context and others are not? Abhijit, if you can hear us. Okay, I think I've lost Abhijit there, so let me quickly get in Sumit on the same thought. Sumit, why one thing in a religious context and the other not?
I think, Rishabh, there are two points to make here. The point number one is that, you know, today, tomorrow, somewhere 10, 20, 50 years later, people are going to really, really examine the Sanatan or Hindu way of life and consider it as something which is prevalent and which appeals to humanity, not to a particular religion. So first of all, you are trying to suppress that. Second point is that you want to make it communal so that you can separate it out. But tomorrow, if Ramayana or Ram's way of life or Ram's model of governance is followed by everywhere in the world, it will be the Hindu influence.
So my question is,
which will cover
if,
the world.
If a lot of people, now we,
it's a political coup to stop it.
We follow a democratic republican model, okay? For many countries across the globe, okay, and these are models that came out of Greece and Rome, right? We follow certain constitutional precepts that came out of what you just told us, liberty, equality, fraternity. That's the French Revolution, okay? So that does not mean, so if I say I'm a democratic republic, that doesn't mean I'm Christian or Muslim. So if I say I'm Ram Rajya or my constitution is defined by Ram Rajya, okay, just like the word democratas and republicanism, would that mean that there is an attempt at a Hindu global takeover? Sumit Peer.
No, not at all, Rishabh, because whatever is good, it has to originate from something. Let's say you argue democracy came from Greece and liberty came from France. That doesn't make us Greek, neither that makes us French, neither that makes us Christian. But if something has to come from somewhere, obviously there will be a lot of good things which will come from the oldest serving civilization on planet Earth. It's high time for world to embrace whatever is good for you. You might not be a Hindu, but you can still follow the Ramas or Rama's teachings. Why are they doing it in Indonesia, which is the biggest Muslim population?
Okay, okay, okay. So just on that thought, Abhijit, sorry we just lost you a second ago. And this was my question to you, okay? That if we were, and I'm having a hypothetical conversation because I don't want to have a massive controversy on Diwali is not a day for controversies. But you know what would happen if somebody in this country said, you know, that the nature of our civilization and therefore the construct of our constitution should be based on Ram Rajya. We would be accused of creating Hindu Rashtra. Okay. So when we take Greek values of republic that came out of Plato, of democracy, French values and American values, okay, in terms of we the people, why is Ram Rajya therefore religious and what is to fear in that?
See, essentially the Indian state is designed to suppress Indian civilization. Isn't that what it is? And all these concepts that we just discussed, liberty, equality, fraternity, we the people, etc. These all are part of Ram Rajya. These are all mentioned in various parts of our canon. So I don't think it's at all religious in any sense at all. There is nothing religious about Ram Rajya. It is the same beliefs and the precepts that the world follows, but it is followed imperfectly. Right, the Judeo-Christian Westphalian model of the world that we have today, the way the world is governed, it is extremely imperfect. It has caused lots of misery, wars, etc. So it is high time that India presents an alternative civilizational outlook.
It need not be alternative per se, because as religion, as we are told by our own religious reformers, that you know you can have a single truth and many paths to it. So human value systems or our end of history can have one goal, but many paths to it. But the question I'm trying to understand is a very fundamental one. Hindul Sen Gupta, if I went and said that I represent democratic, republican, liberal values, those would be considered aspirational in large parts of the world. And people will, you know, pat you on the back and say, exactly, that's what India should be. Democratic, republic, liberal, secular. But if I say that I would like an India to represent the concepts of a Ram Rajya, I would be accused of imposing a Hindu Rashtra. Now, I'm trying to figure out why. Why should I aspire to Greek, Romano values and their transliterations more than the very same that were here long before them?
Well, the reason for that is basically twofold, Rishabh. Number one, please understand, when do certain attributes of different cultures become norms around the world? They become norms when those cultures and those states come to the forefront of prosperity and military power in the committee of the world. They become great powers, so to speak. That's what happened with Britain, that's what happened with America, that's what's happening with China. India, if India wants its cultural values to become norms, it must simultaneously push for its rightful position, both militarily and economically in the world. That's number one. Number two, Indians themselves have to adopt these virtues.
Yeah.
Point asking other people to adopt it if Indians themselves don't adopt it. That makes no sense.
Okay.
I have to love my mother first before somebody else respects her.
Absolutely. So and this is the premise of why I'm having this conversation. This is the only premise. And I just want to leave you with this premise. And it's just based on two questions which you can ask and answer yourself. Imagine what would happen in this country, right? If somebody even mentioned that we aspire to a constitutional framework based on Ram Rajya. Okay? It would be pandemonium. So if it would be, and we can predict pandemonium would happen, we have to ask why. Why would there be pandemonium? Why should I take Plato's word for it? That his definition of how human society should upgrade itself is better than what our Indic definition was before Plato. Why should I take the word of the Roman Republic, or why their definition of the 12 tables and having a legal system was better? Similarly, why should I take the British word for it or the American word for it, who then in turn, in their Capitol Hill and in their Senate, tried to replicate what they thought their ideals were? And if they were based on ideals, it boils down to a question I just said, that if you were to describe yourself as a Republican Democrat, we the people aspire in this country to be this, you would be lauded. But if you said that we the people aspire to be what was already the value chain in India, you are by nature a majoritarian. It's a fascinating conversation. I can't understand why that exists. And maybe it's a conversation we need to have. So on this occasion of this Diwali, I wish you happy Diwali. And amidst the lights and diyas, a thought to ponder. We leave it there.
For more such videos, subscribe to the NewsX YouTube channel. Hit the bell icon.